the Vietnamese peace death exam, for example, which I've seen, and there's other exams. If you're teaching reading skills, this type of thing is really important because students have to read under time pressure. If they identify that the question is asking about facts, then they scan for certain information in the text. Numbers would be one of the things they might look for. Number two, fact or opinion?
Opinion.
There's a couple of clues here. First of all, we get the good news is that. This is kind of interesting because this is a piece of authentic English. Do you know if you've taught the language of opinion in your language classes, you've probably told the students... Everybody's still pretending they're listening.
Go on, try that one. Okay. We teach students to express opinions. What phrases do you teach them to express an opinion? In my opinion, I think. Generally, yeah? It's in the course book and we teach them. That's great, but actually, people have studied the language of opinions and they put the phrase in my opinion through a computer. And they discovered how it works. And it's very interesting, because if you're doing, in Britain, where I'm from in England, we don't start a sentence with in my opinion, in reality. For example, if I say the internet is bad for you, if I was in England, I wouldn't say in my opinion, the internet's bad for you. I'd say, the internet's bad for you, in my opinion. We almost say it as an apology. We're apologising for having an opinion. In American English, they tend to put in my opinion more at the beginning of the sentence, and they're more direct with it. So it's a kind of interesting cultural difference. But here, students discover a phrase like, the good news is that, and they think, oh, I could use that piece of language, that's opinion language. Also, the word excellent, students discover that adjectives express opinions. Now, typically in class, if I was explaining adjectives to students, I'd tell them a phrase like, the big red bus, and they'd learn that adjectives describe nouns, words like big and red describe nouns. But actually, here, they discover that we use adjectives to express opinions, which is an interesting discovery for them to make. Because when they're doing exams and they're answering questions about the author's opinion, they're going to be looking for adjectives, some of the language they'll be looking for. Number three, fact or opinion. Factual, it's got numbers, it also refers to time, hard facts, but they're discovering this. Four and five are reporting people's opinion, so they discover the use of think that, and said they, so it's reporting language. Number six is an opinion, and we discover the importance of modal verbs and the fact that we use modal verbs to express opinions. Now, I could tell students all of that, but this exercise makes them discover it. And I think both are important, that we tell students, but also that they discover it. And that's why the critical thinking activities can really help in that way. And the brain is working harder. Okay. The third thing that critical thinking leads to is, I think, more motivating classroom activities. They're just more fun to do in class if you can integrate critical thinking. Let's try some activities. If any of you teach younger learners, the next activity is kind of fun to do with students. Do you know who this is? Firstly, it's a fairly universal symbol, yeah? It's Nemo. What happened to Nemo? He got lost. And who went to find Nemo? His father, we've got some real Disney fans here, okay? If you haven't seen the film. So Nemo gets lost, his father goes to find him, his father brings him back home. That's basically the story. What is fantastic about Pixar films is, one, the animation is great, but the second thing is the storytelling. And Pixar have a secret. If you watch any Pixar film and you analyze it, they use the same structure in their stories every time. And it's really helpful if you're a language teacher. Because if you ever ask students to write stories, quite often they start, but then there's no structure to the story. Yeah? But what Pixar does is they use a 6-sentence structure which allows them to create any kind of story they want, and it's called the Pixar Secret. And I'm going to give the Pixar Secret to you now, and you can get students to write the most perfect stories very quickly and use their creative thinking. Here's the 6-sentence structure. So, once upon a time, there was a fish called Nemo. Yep. Every day, Nemo went to school. One day, Nemo got lost. Because of that, his father went to look for him. Because of that, his father crossed the Pacific Ocean on the back of a turtle and arrived in Australia. That one's slightly more complicated. Until finally, he found Nemo and brought him home, and they all lived happily ever after. Now, this is true in every Pixar film. The other thing is, if you want students to write really good stories and think critically and creatively, it really helps students because you give them a template. And sometimes we ask students to do kind of creative tasks without giving them the framework and the template to do it, and they find it really hard. Let's test out the Pixar secret. You're going to do a quick creative thinking task. With the person next to you, you are going to create a story in 2 minutes using your critical and creative thinking. I'm going to give you the first line of the story, and then I just want you to create the story. So here's the first line. Once upon a time, there was an English teacher in Hanoi. Okay, go, write your story with the partner, or speak it.